Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. We'd like to welcome you all here this morning, and Mr. Kruger has our call to worship.
Call to worship is from Acts 13, 47. For so the Lord has commanded us, I have set you as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be for salvation to the ends of the earth.
Please stand as we sing our opening song, "'Tis Love That Makes Us Happy." Join us in bowing our heads. Dear Lord, we come before you now and welcome you into this room, and please invite your Holy Spirit into our hearts. Thank you for the opportunity to praise your name here together, and please be with Pastor Nathan as he brings us your word today. Amen. Our next song is When the Church of Jesus, and you'll notice some of our songs this morning are a little bit sombering. We tried to reflect what the sermon was about, the salty life, if you can remain standing at this time.
By the way you gave. Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to the Brunswick Seventh-day Adventist Church this morning, to our members and our guests. It's nice and warm in here this morning compared to outside, and we're happy that you can be here this morning to worship the Lord. I have a few announcements that I'd like to bring to your attention. They have been on the screen up front, and they're also in your bulletin, but I think they're worthy of mentioning this morning. Next Sabbath is a big Sabbath here in Brunswick. Pathfinders are having their training, and Adventurer Club are having their training session here all weekend long. If you are going to be here next Sabbath, it's going to be a normal service, but we ask you, if you're going to be staying for the fellowship meal, could you please bring something? And it's my understanding that they're trying to simplify the fellowship meal, and they are going to do haystacks. So if you're going to come and stay for the fellowship meal, we would ask that you bring something that's appropriate for a haystack meal, whether that's chips or a vegetable or beans or whatever it may happen to be. And I think the other thing that they've asked folks to do is when you come, please come prepared. So the vegetables are already chopped up and prepared and ready to serve. And that will streamline the food preparation and make for a much more enjoyable time next Sabbath. So please keep that in mind. A reminder to the Finance Committee and Church Board. Finance Committee meets on Monday at 6:15, followed immediately by the Church Board at 7, so please keep that in mind. That is this coming Monday at 6:15 and at 7 o'clock. Two sad things to mention. There will be a memorial service today here for Vernon Best. We invite you to attend that if you would like to. It is at 2:30 this afternoon. And then next Monday, a memorial service for Nancy Lord. Many of you are very familiar with Nancy and Bob Lord. If you would like to attend that, it will be here next Monday, the 27th of January at 11 o'clock in the sanctuary. So please keep those announcements in mind. As the deacons come forward to wait upon us this morning, I would ask that you consider the needs of our local church budget. We definitely are running much closer to our budgeted amount, and that is good, good news. On a cold day like today, I guarantee you we are using quite a bit of fuel to keep the sanctuary warm. And we all enjoy that very much. One of the things that the local church budget offering funds is paying the gas bill. Our need each week, when you take our local church budget into account, is roughly $4,000 per week, each and every week of the year. Through your faithful giving, we are close to budget. And I ask, as you return your tithes, you consider the local needs of our church here in Brunswick as well. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, thank you that you have provided so much to us. We are grateful for what you have done for us, and out of a grateful heart, we return to you that which is rightfully yours. Father, I ask that you bless our tithes and our offerings, that they may go to further your work here in the Brunswick community, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. It's time now for the children's story, and we would ask that the children step out into the aisles, and we ask that the congregation please hold out those dollar bills or $5 bills as the children take up the worthy student offering. Mr. Delaware, I'm sure, has a wonderful story for the kids this morning. Please come forward.
Good morning. So, I want to talk to you about rules today. Who knows what rules are? Anyone want to venture?
Yeah. What are rules?
Things that you're supposed to do.
Right. Very good. Exactly. Things that you're supposed to do. So, I know rules sometimes maybe not be a favorite thing. But it's a good thing in the world to have to keep the world a calm and peaceful place, right? So, you know, some examples of rules might be at school or at home, right? At school, you can't chew gum in class, or you can't run in the hallways, and that type of stuff. Are there rules in the Bible? Yes. Yes. What do you know what the rules are called in the Bible?
Already, if you hit someone in the face.
Yes, that is a rule you do not want to break. That is definitely a rule you do not want to break. So rules in the Bible are actually called commandments. And there's actually one that I feel is not even an official commandment, but it kind of is the underlying meaning of many of them. Do you have any idea what that rule might be that's in the Bible?
If you hit someone in the face when you're running down the hall.
Yeah, that's breaking two rules. You're running and you hit. So definitely do not want to do that. So the rule in the Bible that I am talking about is... Does anyone know what the golden rule is? Yeah. I'm on to you. So the golden rule is the rule to treat others as you want to be treated. So do you think if at home or at school, if you followed this rule and kind of everything you said and did, it would be a better place, maybe a peaceful place, more of a happy place for all that was there? Do you think that would be the case? See, I'd like to even take it further, right? So thinking about the world, right? Right now in the world, and there's some bad stuff going on in the world. There's fighting, and there's wars, and there's hunger. If we kind of all practice the golden rule, right? It's a simple rule. Treat others like you want to be treated. You want to make people happy, you want to feel happy. What if we did this, not only at school, but at home, but what if, like, the mayor of your town treated the mayor of the next town the same way, treated him kindly, or the governor of one state treated the governor of another state kindly? What if countries treated other countries kindly? Do you think there would be more wars or less wars? Okay, I'm going to give you a chance. Do you think there would be more wars or less wars if we treated everyone kind, like we want to be treated?
Or if you, like, have a sword when you have, when, or maybe, like, a gun when you're playing Gulf War?
Yeah, that's true.
Or maybe playing Sword War?
Yeah, well, playing Sword War is okay. What I'm talking about is... It's going off the rails here. So what I'm talking about is if we all, leaders of countries, like the president of my country, or the prime minister of another country, or a leader of another country, if they talked nice to each other and treated each other nice and were trying to be fair, do you think there would be more or less wars and less fighting? I'm thinking there'd be a lot less wars and fighting, right? I think if we did it at that scale, but we think locally, we think at our schools and in our homes, treating each other nicely, and the same other kids in other towns did the same things in other countries, that I'm thinking when you guys became adults, if you practiced that, there would be no wars in this world. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to challenge you guys to actually this week to go out and everything you say or do, think about the golden rule. How would I want to be treated? Am I talking to that person nicely? How would you want that person to talk to you? Am I playing fair in this game? These are all things that they seem small, but they're big in the big scheme of things. So I'm challenging you to go out this week and think about that in everything you say or do. And I really think if we all did this, I imagine that we truly could make heaven a place on earth. You can all go back to your seat now. Amen.
Good morning, church. Good morning. I'm going to invite Garrett Truby up. We're our connections this morning, and I've got something to say from India too, but I'll leave that for later. My daughter sent a note just for us this morning. So Garrett, join me on one of these. I guess I'll pick this one, and you can have the other one. Thanks. Garrett got drug up here this morning, actually willingly. I just want to talk for a few minutes about this thing called stewardship. Money. We don't talk about stewardship too much anymore, but money. And it really comes down to this, as the church and the finance committee sits down and we look at the budget and we say, how do we get this thing to work? And then I put slides up that show the church budget, and it's not up there now, but Church Finance Committee has conversations about how do we make finances work. And then I get concerned that eventually it's going to sound like a broken record, or this is all the church is about, let's make the church work. But fundamentally, the money is going to come to support the mission of the church. The real question for me, as we had that conversation last night, or the real thought for me that came was this. The church, when it comes to finances, is not really needing to be an organization that says, hey, give us your money so we can do this. but an organization that helps build disciples who experience financial wellness. And or as you mentioned last night, there's this money thing called Financial Peace University. And, you know, I think that's really, for me, that's really important that we don't get off into, as a church, where we just think about the money for the church, but that it's always underpinned by this sense that the church is really not here primarily to gather money, to do mission, but is here to help people build lives, and part of that includes financial wellness. And that's why you're up here, because we've kind of had a dialogue over time. And so after my monologue, you've had a story dealing with experiencing financial wellness. And I would love to hear like the nutshell of that story this morning. Some are familiar with that story, but just tell us that story again.
Sure. I don't think God needs our money. He allows us to participate in the financial aspect of things, so giving back to him, not only to our churches, but also to people in our community who need that. And I think that's a big portion. I'm a huge proponent of being able to participate in your own life in certain things. So whether that's financially, whether that's spiritually, whether that's fitness and health-wise, we should be able to be kind of our own advocate in those areas. And I think for finance, it's the same thing. Like God gives us the opportunity to give back to him, not for his need, because he can supply everything, but because it helps our hearts. Mm. My wife and I were turned on to Dave Ramsey, which is, he's a Christian finance guy. If any of you guys have ever heard of him, he's a syndicated radio host, and he's got this Financial Peace program. I think it maybe even has been done here at the church. And so we started doing the at-home program. And I came out of school after doing my doctorate in physical therapy with $125,000 in debt, which, you know, I'm sure you guys, it's all over the news, like the CNN, you know, crisis with kids coming out of school with tons of debt and all that kind of stuff. And I literally just thought it was going to be something that hung around forever. Like you just kind of pay a little bit and you just kind of go and go and go. And the nuts and bolts basically of that is that he kind of will give you a kick in the tush and say, hey, you got to get this out of your house. You got to take care of business. And so with his motivation going through his program, his motivation and you know, Jenny's support and both of us being on the same page with it, we were able to knock that out, get rid of all that debt within 3 years.
That's awesome. Did it make a difference?
Huge difference. Yeah, for us, for one, just starting the program alone helped put us on the same page. It was one of the biggest contentions in our marriage, actually. We just viewed and valued money differently.
Anybody raising them? Yeah.
I won't ask for a raising. But yeah, it was, and you know, we're pretty compatible. Things are pretty easy for us. But this is one of the things that was kind of the thing, just because we value money differently. And when we were able to put a kind of conversation to it and have a conversation, it made things so much better for us to have the same conversation. It didn't change how much money we make, but it did change the way that we talk about it, and it did change the way that we value it. And like we said last night, Dave talks a lot about putting, you know, knowing where your money is or directing where your money is instead of wondering where it went. And it doesn't have to be Dave or anything like that, but it's being financially well, like you talked about, is the same thing as being spiritually well. It's the same thing as being fitness and healthy.
Yeah, and I thought that was interesting last night in our conversation that you said, you know, you equated financial wellness. Well, let me just say, I don't remember all the details, but the idea was that it, like, if someone is not financially well, it inhibits spiritual wellness. Just like being physical, like if you're always suffering with serious headaches, that's going to have an impact on your spirit and even on your spiritual life is really going to be impacted by that. So if there's something health-wise that can help relieve that, there's some correlation there with the financial wellness.
100%. Yeah. If you're super worried about how you're going to pay your bills, if you're super worried about, like, you know, your heart or your weight or whatever, you're not going to be able to have spiritual peace. You're not going to be able to have as good of a connection with God or with Jesus, because your attention is distracted and it's taken other places. Now I believe God can give you that peace. And I think one of those ways is that he gives us things in our lives. So like someone to motivate you to go out for a run, someone to motivate you to start budgeting, someone to motivate you to connect with other people because you're feeling lonely. There's so many ways that I think that God gives us those things in our lives. And I think the financial aspect is just one of those pieces.
Yeah, and so we talked last night, and our conversation was, let's offer something that will be a tool. It's the new year, and a lot of us are thinking about lots of things. And one of those things we think about this time of year is, what does 2020 or what does this new year look like financially? And so we wanted to make a tool available that you're willing to be kind of a coach and kind of a spearhead on going through the tool. Maybe tell us about that.
Well, yeah. So like I mentioned, the Financial Peace University with Dave Ramsey, they have a program that do it in churches all over the country. I know you guys, I think, have done it here before. If anybody's interested in it this year, I believe it's a lifetime membership. So if you buy it the one time, I think it's $100. And you can go through it as many years as you want in a row. Any church, any place. If you move to Mississippi, please don't. But if you move to Mississippi, you can go to a place down there that they have the you know. So anyhow, it's a good program. I think it would be, you know, beneficial for a lot of people. And I would be willing to lead out and help out with that. So contact me or Nathan, and if you're interested at all. If you don't feel like you have the funds or finances available, we can work that out, I think,
absolutely,
as well. So don't let that be a barrier for you. Contact us, and we'll see what we can do. If there's enough interest, then I believe it's a 9-week program. We would meet, I think it's one night a week, and it's basically some DVDs and then group discussion type stuff, and there's some workbooks involved. But again, from my story alone, and I've listened to his radio program and other things, and then talked with countless other people who have, we actually went on his show. He's got a radio show that we went on. They also do a TV thing that's streamed online. So Jenny and I went on there after we did our debt payoff. And I got a lot of messages on Facebook from other people that were like, oh man, we're just so, that's so awesome. We're so, you know, inspired by that. Mm-hmm. And then I had people contact me years later that said, we saw you on there, we thought we could do it, and now we are debt-free
that's
too.
Awesome.
And they were like super pumped about it. And that was just so cool to be able to give back. So that's one
that's
of the reasons
awesome.
For this is for us to be able to give back to other people.
That's
to
awesome.
To kind of grab the reins and say, like, you know, we want to change our financial literacy and our stewardship so that we can, mm-hmm. you know, potentially give back to others as well.
Amen. So just a plug-in for you, whatever the new year looks like, whatever your finances look like, this is one opportunity that you can take advantage of. And the contact information, my email, as well as the church office email, either of those you can email to, and we'll make sure to hook you up with Garrett. You can talk to Garrett in person, talk to me in person. But we want to make sure that we're available to help facilitate your financial wellness as we try to facilitate other kinds of wellness, and that's just one we're talking about this morning. Thank you, Garrett.
You bet.
Appreciate it. You can put it over there.
Seated at this time as we come before God singing, "What Does the Lord Require?"
Thank you. Now is the time for us to have corporate prayer. Before we do so, there are just a few things that I'd like to bring to your attention that we want to keep in our prayers. The mission trip that some of our members are on in India, we want to make sure that we're keeping them lifted up. John Getford, who is not feeling well and has had some medical issues. And just a general prayer for health. You know, now is the time of year where folks get sick and they're out. And we know that there are others that are not just dealing with normal sickness, but that have serious medical issues. I think of Terry Jackson, the Opalniks. And I know that there are many other unspoken prayers. So I would ask now, wherever possible, if you'll kneel with me as we pray together. Heavenly Father, we are grateful that we have the opportunity to come to your sanctuary, Lord, to meet and commune with you in a different way that we are accustomed to during the week. We thank you for the care, protection, and love that you have shown for us, Lord. A love that was willing to give up eternity for our salvation. We thank you for your dear son, his willingness to give up his life, to give up glory for humanity. We spat in his face, we beat him, we considered him afflicted, yet still he was willing to show an eternal love for us. Lord, we ask that that same love may be seen in your people. As we go out every day interacting with people who have no desire to hear of you, Lord, we ask for an indwelling of your Holy Spirit, that your light may shine through us, that men may see Christ in every aspect of our lives. We also come to you, Lord, with our petitions. We have mentioned some, and again, I know that there are many that go unmentioned, Lord. You know the deep desires of our heart, Lord, the pain that some in this church and those hearing my voice are going through right now. Help us, Lord, not to lose our faith. It is our desire, Lord, for healing for everyone. But we know that that is not the case in some circumstances. So when things don't go the way that we desire, Lord, help us not to turn away from you, but to look up into heaven and be reassured that this temporal life is not the end, that there is more in store for us, Lord, that there are greater things beyond the pain and suffering in this world, and that we only have to have faith in you. Give us your spirit that we may stand strong when temptation and doubt assail us, Lord, that we can be a beacon of light to those around us. Lord, I want to lift up Nathan now as he prepares to bring the message to your people, as he preaches on what it means to be salt, Lord. Help us to be the salt for this community, to give the flavor of the gospel, to prepare for your soon coming, Lord. We thank you and ask that these prayers will be heard according to your will, and that if there is anything in our lives, Lord, any sin, that it may be revealed to us, that we will repent and turn away from it, Lord, and walk hand in hand with you into the gates of glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men.
Good morning, church. A word from Abby this morning. She texted me and asked me to relay a message to you this morning. Hi, church family. Greetings to you from India. I want to fill you in on just a few things that have been going on this past week that I've been here, traveled here. We got to Qatar, thanks to the Lord, and we made it safely to Chennai, India, without any issues. Immigration was nerve-wracking. They asked us who we were and why we were there. At immigration, we couldn't tell them about the work we were doing, so we told them we were touring. Then they asked where we were staying while we would be in Goa. That was the scariest part because we didn't know. I was very afraid we wouldn't be let through, but God got us through. Praise His name. Anyway, when we got to Chennai, we rode a metro train to another sleeper train, which then took us to Angola, where we are staying at a school. Our first meeting was Friday night, and let me tell you, it was absolutely amazing. The children were swarming us, and we got hugs, and they held our hands. I'll never forget this experience I've had so far. It was so awesome. Today, we drove an hour away to a village where we dedicated a church to a woman on the team's deceased husband. She is a very, very kind lady. We were met with garlands and flower petals were thrown on us in greetings and celebration. Thank you all for supporting me on this trip. Chloe and Anna send their hellos, and we miss you all very much. Much love to my immediate family and my church family. You are all very much missed. Have a happy Sabbath, and God bless. And she says that if you want to see some of her daily posts on Instagram, she is Victoria_Abigail2004. So you're welcome to look her up on Instagram. Salt, and by the way, welcome to our YouTube viewers. We're so glad to have you as part of our church family here. Please feel free to reach out to us through our website and share with us your thoughts or prayer requests. Let's pray. God, thank you so much that we can be here this morning as we continue to reflect on the teachings of Jesus. Amen. Two more today and next week in our journey through the Beatitudes. I don't know how long it'll take us, but we'll be on it for a while. But we're going to end this first run, and we'll pick it up sometime in the future. Two more today, salt, and next week, light. Salt and light, two pretty different things, and different impact and different illustrative value. Here's a little bit on salt. Before the advent of the modern internal combustion engine, salt was difficult to get and, in fact, was equal value with gold at certain times in history. The word salary is derived from salt. Roman soldiers were paid in part with salt, and salary was derived from that Roman reference to salt. You may have heard the term, is he or she worth their salt? I bought salt yesterday, a little one of those Morton-sized containers of salt for 54 cents. But there was a time when that kind of salt, in fact, I watched a great documentary. You can find the link if you go to the church Facebook page and look at the Friday Digital Bulletin. In the show notes, there's a link to a documentary that's about 50 minutes long. Fascinating just on the salt mining trade. One of the salt mines one of the salt stories in the documentary is about a salt flat in Bolivia where it's a 70-mile straight road. It's like a mathematically straight road, according to the documentary, out into this salt flat where there is this like hill and a very small civilization out in the middle of this Bolivian salt lake. And they harvest salt there. That's like what the whole community is built around, is harvesting salt. And one of the things on the documentary is documenting one of the last llama herds to transport salt on a 42-day trek to a remote village. So they put like 30 pounds of salt on this, on each animal in this flock of llamas, and for 42 days the herder travels to and then distributes the salt in exchange for corn, and then travels 42 days back. The llamas rest for the entire year after that single trip. It's so wearing on them. So, but there's a huge salt mining contraption on a lake, boy, somewhere in Europe. There is a couple of other pictures. Here's one of them. This picture is of, this mine is talked about in the documentary as well. This is in Poland, and it was mined by such a large number of Catholic miners, and I have no idea what just happened, but I am not on the screen. Okay, there we are, back. And they built a cathedral. Those chandeliers are made from salt, and a bunch of really high-quality statues and other carvings are down in this salt mine. You may have heard of this town. Hallstatt came up on the news recently as being overrun by tourism, but it was a central salt source all the way back to 8 BC. Records go all the way back to 8th century BC. It is I think it's in Geneva, not Geneva, but in Bavaria, and it's one of the most important salt sources in that region of Europe. Several mines in the area that have supplied salt to the region. I'm not sure if they currently supply salt, but in ages past was an incredibly important salt source. Here is the top of the largest salt mine in the world. It's located in Ontario, Canada. And the salt mine is some 1,700 feet below the surface, including under Lake Huron. And has produced 150 million tons of salt. And that was by 2012, so that number is bigger today. Here's another salt mine. This one is in Mayo. I'm sorry, this one is in India, called the Mayo Salt Mine. And it's not in India, it's in Pakistan, right there on the border of India, and it was named after like an Indian lord who visited it, and his name was Mayo. So salt. Kind of an important thing if you're if you have medical awareness, you know that sodium is incredibly important to nerve function, muscle function. We don't need a lot of sodium, but if you don't have it, you will die. Salt does lots of other things too. It affects the stuff it gets into. If you put salt in food, they say not only does it taste better, well, you know it tastes better, but salt actually frees up the aromatic particles in food, and so food with salt in it smells better. Salt helps melt sidewalks. Salt helps preserve food. Salt is all around us in one form or another. And again, not just table salt. I've got rock salt here, which you might use to make ice cream or melt your sidewalk, and table salt. Both of them rather common here in the States. I want to show you a little experiment here. It's not an experiment. I know it's going to work. A little illustration here. This one should come with the caveat, do not try this at home. So I have a light bulb, and just a little incandescent bulb, and a little pigtail. So I'm going to put that in 2 glasses of water. As you know, water has some conductive properties. And then I've got a power cord. And Bob, don't look at this because it's not up to code. So this power cord is live, right? It's hot. I need to change. It'll be fine. So I want you to notice what happens. So the power cord and the bear pigtails are both in the water. And even the water, you know, you're not supposed to be in a lake when the lightning strikes, those kinds of things. But clearly, it's insufficient conductivity to make the light go on. So let's add some salt. So as those salt ions dissolve in the water, they actually enable the water to conduct enough electricity that you can see the light. It's kind of interesting the farther that gets from the source, the light changes. Just a little bit fun there. So we're going to unplug this now. And just again, this is not an experiment to try at home. Our text this morning is there in Matthew chapter 5. There in the Beatitudes, Jesus, right out of the gate after sort of introducing the chapter, Matthew beginning in verse 3, records the Beatitudes, these seven teachings of Jesus with the capstone of blessing on those who are persecuted and maligned for their faith. And then right after the Beatitudes, Jesus jumps into this text and he says, "You are the salt of the earth." Now, we're going to get to the rest of it in a minute. So here Jesus has just outlined what I've called the beatitude life, the kingdom life. And then he looks at the audience and says, "You are the salt of the earth." This is a really powerful moment in the Beatitudes. Here Jesus has just said, after outlining it, that you're going to be persecuted, jump up and down for joy because you're in good company. But then instead of saying something like, so find a quiet place to live out of the way of people so you don't end up getting in trouble, or go just put your head down at work and don't say a word so you can avoid people making fun of you. Instead, he looks at them and says, "You are the salt of the earth." That's you. It's almost like he's saying, "Now listen, yeah, you're going to get persecuted, but you are an essential element in society." In other words, kingdom people can't just walk off into some closet or some cave somewhere. Kingdom people must get into the world because kingdom people are the salt of the earth. Today's going to be a little different than usual. Instead of processing Bible texts, we're going to spend some time reflecting on this idea of salt and then reflecting on the impact of salt in society, because the single thing I want you to take away today is this simple statement by Jesus that you are the influence in society that brings the impact of the kingdom into the workplace and the home life, into the office life and the school life and the church life. Like, you are the way the kingdom gets in, and I say you, I'm talking about all of us. Like, we are the way the kingdom diffuses into the society around us. If we don't function as that diffusing agent, the question really truly can be asked, how then is the influence of the kingdom moving into the workplace? Who's there to bring these incredible kingdom principles, this incredible kingdom life into the lives of the people in society? I'm going to take you to John Piper. John Piper, I quoted him in the digital bulletin, but I want to bring it back to you. Here is this really succinct statement from Pastor Piper. He says, "People don't enjoy salt." Like, really. Nobody is dying to take the spoon and shovel the salt down. If you are, you need to go see your doctor, because that's probably a really bad medical condition. Salt, in fact, if when you put it in your mouth, if you put enough of it in, you have this really nasty reaction, because salt in that kind of quantity is just nasty. And John's kind of getting at that. People don't enjoy salt. They enjoy what is salted. We are the salt of the earth. We do not exist for ourselves. Let that sink in as you think about these words of Jesus. You and I are not meant for church. We should think about our church building. We should think about our organizational structure. We should think about those kinds of things that help us function. But fundamentally, the believer is not made for the church. The believer is made for the world. Our effectiveness, our impact as Christians doesn't begin when we come and sit here. The impact of the church is measured by what we do when the doors of the church close behind us and the doors of the dental office open up, or the doors of the grocery store open up, or the cashier smiles at us at the gas station. That's when the work of the church really happens, because Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. The world is changed because you and I, as kingdom-transformed individuals, are present in society." I want you to think with me for a few moments about some people that have been transformation agents in society. You heard of this woman? Sojourner Truth was a slave turned abolitionist, and she became a Methodist and was called to ministry. She preached a sermon, "Ain't I a Woman," in 1851 that demanded equality for women and African Americans. She was a salt woman in the world. Now, not everybody in the world that makes a difference and brings kingdom values into the world, unless they're going to be famous like Sojourner Truth. But Sojourner Truth made an impact because she was unwilling to simply be in her spot. She was not willing to simply sit down and mind her own business. Sojourner Truth allowed the kingdom principles to use her as an influence in her society. And our world today is different because somebody left the salt shaker. Think of another major figure, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Mentioned him more than once in this series. But his life, again, was anchored to this conviction born of his faith that he couldn't simply sit by. He stepped into the action. It cost him his life, but he did it. And he, as one grain of salt, has been a transformative influence in American and global culture. George Mueller, responsible for some 10,000 orphaned and abandoned children. George Mueller has inspired hundreds of thousands of prayers. As his story came out, Mueller, with these orphanages outside the city of Bristol, England, ministering to kids who had been orphaned through a terrible plague of cholera, epidemic of cholera. The stories that came out and that followed him were stories of a man who, when there wasn't enough bread in the orphanage, he and his wife would talk to God, and the bread would show up. In fact, Mueller, whose ministries were supported by faith and prayer, was was also giving to support mission work in India. Here he is, engaged himself in mission work, a mission sustained by prayer, and yet he's willing to take his blessings and pour them into the work in another country. See, the world is transformed by the influence of salty people. You might recognize this name, William Wilberforce, whose life story is, or partially, is captured in the film Amazing Grace. William Wilberforce was a major force in the abolition of some 700,000 slaves through his work in England as a member of the House of Commons. One man, because of his faith, was an influence on other men and other women and other people and moved a nation and liberated a people. What impact will your life have, will my life have, as I sink and dissolve, as it were, into the community around me? Is my life a transformative influence? Catherine Booth, wife of, I believe it was William Booth, founder of the Salvation Army. She was a street preacher in England, specifically London, and she was influential in raising up other women preachers who proclaimed the gospel of Jesus. She was influential in sparking a movement to help the poor and underserved. You probably recognize this name, William Penn. We have a state named after him, Pennsylvania. William Penn was a man also of great faith, and William's faith led him to do things like treat the Indians with kindness. William's faith led him to build a culture, a political community of mutual respect. And his legacy of how people get along who don't necessarily see eye to eye still impacts how we operate as a nation. Nicholas Copernicus, known for his astronomy. Again, a man of faith who influenced society. And this man, Johann Kepler, a German astronomer and accomplished scientist who coined the term thinking God's thoughts after him. What kind of salt are you and I? What kind of salt, what kind of difference as my life infiltrates the lives of the people beside me? What kind of difference do I make? There's the story of a mother whose son was murdered. And she made it a point to get to know the son, the boy who had murdered her son. She later asked that boy to become her son. Now, you and I may not have that kind of dramatic story. We may not be a Johann Kepler or Nicholas Copernicus or a George Mueller. But what about that person who wouldn't give up inviting my friend and kept inviting him to church? And to this day, he's an elder in Sitka, Alaska, because somebody kept showing up. What about that quiet son who kept showing up at his dying father's bedside and whose life inspired others to act in kindness in their circles? There are so many stories of people who have changed the society around them. There's Isaac Newton. There's George Washington Carver. There's Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene has probably been the most prolific financial contributor to the church throughout history by her simple, selfless gift She has been the inspiration for people giving to support building projects, community projects. She has been the inspiration for people to lay down themselves to bless others by the simple act of her unselfish kindness to Jesus. That's salt. Mary didn't think, man, I'm going to go do this thing for Jesus. I'm going to spend all this money and get this special perfume, and I'm going to go to this party, and I'm going to break it on Jesus' feet, and when I go, it's going to fill the room, and the story's going to get out, and then for hundreds and, well, more than 2,000 years, my story's going to be told, and it's going to change lives. No, she was just thinking, I love Jesus. And I want Jesus to know that I love him. In other words, she was just living the kingdom life. The whole idea of being salt isn't that Jesus introduces some new formula for being salty. It's that after sharing the kingdom principles, he says, you're the salt. Now that you know the way to experience the kingdom power, you're the salt. You're the way this stuff gets into the world as you simply live out the kingdom life. You are a transformative influence in the society in which you live. Not by some great formula, not by some important committee meeting or policy manual, but simply you and me living out the transforming journey of the Christian life. We change society. There's Nate Saint, the Wildani people in Ecuador were such a violent people that it looked like their civilization would end in death. Not because somebody was coming in, but because they were so bloodthirsty and ruthless toward each other that these tribes are literally killing each other off. Group of mission-minded couples traveled there, and Nate and four of his friends made contact with these violent people. You may have heard the story in the 1950s or since then. All five of these friends died, leaving their wives, widows, and children behind them, orphans. Well, not orphans, but fatherless there in the jungles of Ecuador. And yet to this day, because Nate was willing to be salt in that Ecuadorian jungle, the people of the Wildani tribe live in peace. And the fact that the tribe is still present is itself a miracle, virtually a miracle, because of the gospel bringing peace between people who hated each other. There's Frederick Douglass. There's Fanny Crosby, whose words, some 8,000 hymns written by a woman who's blind, I bet have brought hope to your heart. Words that have lifted the dark shadows from the minds of hopeless men and women around the world. Because she was willing to be salt. She was willing to tell her story with what she had, as limited as it was because of her sight. And she, like salt, diffused into history and has been a change agent. John D. Rockefeller, you may not know it, but he was a huge contributor to Christian education, huge contributor to other Christian work. Dag Hammarskjöld was at one time the Secretary General of the United Nations, and it was during his tenure in the United Nations, he was an important tool in helping some of these countries who were coming to statehood or gaining independence, helping them integrate into the society around them. Again, a believer, here he is, working in the United Nations, not preaching from a pulpit, not being involved in what we would think is a spiritual work, and yet his influence, his faith, was a salty influence to the nations. and then one that we know well, Ellen White. Seventh-day Adventists are some 20 million strong, with a network of educational institutions, hospitals, and work that has impacted the lives of millions of people on our planet. See, we underestimate the power of being salty. And again, this morning, it's not about me needing to give you a big list of what it means to be salt. It just means that you and I live the kingdom life. And as we move out into the society around us, into the culture around us, we are like those ions in this water. We change society. So back to our text. What in the world did Jesus mean when he said, "What good is salt if it has lost its flavor?" We're used to salt coming in this form, very white, purified form. But in Jesus' day, salt was not quite so pure. In fact, salt was so impure that your dish could be full of salt and yet free of sodium chloride. So at that point, you're pretty much putting a pinch of dirt in your soup. And so, you know, in your house, you've been, I don't know if you've noticed, but sometimes in the garage on very humid days, you'll get this wet moisture on the garage floor. It hasn't rained, it's just been humid, and the salt draws in that water. So over time, if that happens, eventually the salt content will dissipate. Something like that is what's happening in those homes. They've got their salt bowl. And over time, whether somebody spills water in it or something happens, the sodium chloride is leached out of that dirty salt. And there's still something in the bowl, but it doesn't help mom's soup. It doesn't save the pickles because it's just plain old salt mine dirt. What happens if you and I show up in the world looking like the salt in that bowl and yet being devoid of kingdom life? What happens to the families that need the healing presence of Jesus, but when I show up, I just contribute to the mess? What happens to the classrooms that need that gentle spirit that comes as the gospel works deep, but when I show up, I'm short-tempered and impatient? What happens to society that needs the visionary that says, "We can't stand by while injustice unfolds. Somebody has got to do something, and I'm going to be the one to start"? What happens if I show up in that society, but the kingdom principles aren't deeply integrated? Who is it that stands up if Dietrich Bonhoeffer doesn't stand up? Who is it that stands up if Sojourner Truth doesn't stand up? Who is it that reaches out to that boy who's murdered another boy if it's not mama? See, we underestimate the importance of the impact of believers who don't show up with salty lives. Our workplace loses something if I don't show up and ooze salt. Your family, your church, the city of Brunswick or Lisbon or Poland is directly impacted by whether or not the believers show up salty or salt-free. I want to wrap up with a couple of thoughts from Bob Goff. You may have heard of his book. He writes Wrote two of them that I know of. This is one of them. Love Does. A couple of you have heard of the book. And full of incredible stories. And I went through, I don't know how I'm ending up going the wrong direction, but here's a picture of Bob. Bob tells the story of teasing his friend, playing a terrible prank. His friend's name is Doug. And Doug finds out that his friend's going to be, has reserved this specific hotel suite for a 10th anniversary. And Bob is not a friend you want to have on your 10th anniversary. Bob and his wife show up early and they check in as the couple. And they proceed to order room service to the tune of hundreds of dollars. And after enjoying all the room service they desired, they tidy the room up, check out. His friend checks in later, none the wiser, until the next morning when the charges show up on their bill. Well, Bob's friend, Doug, apparently still loved the guy, but made it his mission to get him back. One day, Bob received a phone call, and Bob has had it in his mind since that day that his friend was trying to get him back. He has a phone call, and when you prank somebody and you're afraid of getting pranked back, you're kind of spooked. And the voice on the other end of the line was from the country of Uganda and asked him if he was willing to be counsel for the country of Uganda. Ha, 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 Doug, you're so funny. Of course I'm willing. And so Bob went along with this thing until he found himself as the official consul for the country of Uganda. In fact, he discovered that they weren't looking for legal work. They were looking for diplomatic representation to the United States government of America. Bob says this, "The next time God asks you to do something that is completely inexplicable, something you're sure is a prank because it requires a decision or courage that's way over your pay grade, something that might even save lives, say yes." Bob has impressed me with this simple attitude toward life. And I think it's an attitude that's important for us to embrace as salty people. Bob's attitude is a forward-facing attitude of saying yes to opportunities that come his way. Whether it's the person, whether it's the woman that has just totaled his beloved Jeep, whether it's the boy running down the sidewalk looking for a front porch on which to have his wedding, whether it's a friend coming for an afternoon conversation, whether it's a phone call from Uganda looking for a counsel that turns into a diplomatic role. Being salt means living the kingdom life and then saying yes, saying, "God, I'm here. You can use me however, wherever, whenever you need to, because I'm willing to join the ranks of the salty people." You may never become Martin Luther King Jr. and your impact. You may never become a Sojourner Truth or a Mary Magdalene. But you may be that salt that helps influence a family to make forgiveness a reality that's been putting off forgiveness for years. You may be the inspiration that helps that kid have courage to try harder in mathematics. You may be the voice that moves that person to say yes to Jesus who's been putting it off, resisting, running. You may be the voice that helps them find their peace. Because as salt, you've done what Bob's done and you've said, yes, God, I'm present. I want to wrap up with the words to a song by Casting Crowns called One Awkward Moment. She's a castaway, stranded on an island of her yesterdays. Freedom was her ocean, but she got swept away. Little princess, dreaming, got lost somewhere in the waves. Left behind, she's been going at this all alone since she was 9. But God loves you. He's got a plan for you. She's heard all the lines. But when she opens up her heart, nobody's got the time. Could this be the day that you come to the rescue? She's desperate for the light, but she's never going to ask you. One word, one hand. Tell me, is that too high a price? One awkward moment could be the one that saves a life. Your hurt, your scars, God will use to open up her eyes. One awkward moment, you'll see the gospel come alive. Come alive. God, thank you for the teachings of Jesus that enable us to be salty people. People who melt into the world around us and bring the transforming, ionizing influence of the kingdom principles. Whether it's into the workplace or the schoolroom or the home or the conflict or the church. God, help us to leave this place, to leave it with a sense that we are essential in the lives and places where we move. That the kingdom is meant to permeate and influence and alter the society into which we move. Where we live. To spread the kingdom values and impact as far and wide as possible. God, give us courage to live salty lives everywhere we go. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand with us as we sing our closing hymn, This Little Light of Mine.
Let it shine.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you. May he give you peace. Amen.